أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على خاتم النبيين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، وبعد. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. A summary of Surah Al-Kahf. Surah Al-Kahf takes its name from the ninth verse in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ كَانُوا مِنْ آيَاتِنَا عَجَبًا. The surah was revealed in Mecca. It is a Makki surah. And it was revealed in the third stage of the life of prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The prophethood life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Mecca is divided into four stages. And this was the first surah which was revealed in the third stage in Mecca. That means that was the time when the idolaters had started oppressing the Muslims, the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But their oppressive activities were not extensive. In the second stage, they had started only making mockery of the Islamic message and also threatening Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his followers, and trying to make false propaganda to suppress the Islamic movement. In the third stage, they actually started persecution practically. But in the early stages, still it was not extensive. In the later stages of the third stage, the persecution from the kafir side became extensive. This surah was revealed before the hijrah, migration of the companions to Habash. The cause of revelation is three questions asked by the idolaters from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The idolaters, the mushrikeen of Mecca, they consulted the Jews and asked them to give them some questions, hard questions, which they would ask Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to see if he had any source of knowledge, any source of divine knowledge. The Jews gave them these three questions. One was about the Ashabi Kahf, that who were the companions of the cave, those who slept in the cave, who were they? Second question was about the story of Khizr alayhi salam with Musa alayhi salam. And the third question was about Zulkarnain. Who was Zulkarnain, or what did Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam know about Zulkarnain? These questions were related to the stories which were found in the Jews' history and in the Christians' history, but there was no knowledge about these stories in Mecca and in Saudi Arabia. Therefore, these were really very hard questions, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down full and clear answer to all of these three stories and explained everything very well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts this surah with the lesson of Tawheed and resurrection. The subject matter of this surah is At-Tawheed. That means belief in monotheism, belief in the absolute oneness of God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we have to worship only one God, Allah, and we have to obey all the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And second is the resurrection, that we are accountable, we are responsible creation, we are not free of responsibility, and we are returning to our Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where we will be questioned about our faith and deeds, and we will be given reward or punishment according to our faith and deeds. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from hell, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take us to paradise. Ameen. Ya Rabb. So this is the subject matter and the topics of the surah, and the surah starts with such verses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells about the holy book Quran that it is a very straightforward, clear statement, and about about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and gives the lesson of tawhid. And in that lesson of tawhid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also advised Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to warn those who say that Allah has taken a child or a son. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that they are liars. The statement, the words which they utter, those are horrible words, and they are complete false words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala high above of having any relative or any offspring. Allah is the unique being who doesn't need such relations. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started the story of Ashab al-Kahf. They were a few young men who used to worship only one God, Allah, and the emperor of that time was an idolater. He was an oppressor. He was forcing people to worship deities other than Allah. So when he came to know about these Muslims, he called them and he threatened them that if they don't obey him and they don't follow the false deities, then he would kill them. He gave them some time to think about his command. So they went away and they then took advantage of their time, and they decided to leave the city and everything that they had for the cause of Allah, and they trusted Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They went to the mountains to take refuge in a cave. There they slept, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept them sleeping for more than 300 years. And when they woke up, they thought maybe they slept for a short time. They sent one of their friends to bring some food from the market, but go carefully so that nobody knows about us. When their friend went to the market, he was a strange person because he had come to the market after a person belonging to the era 300 years ago. His clothes, his language, his appearance, and especially the coin which he presented to the shopkeeper, belonged to very, very old time, to the old emperor. So they were all surprised, and their people gathered there, and also the news reached the governor. So all of them followed him. They went along with him to the cave, and they saw his other companions. And when those companions of the cave, the Ashab al-Kahf, they came to know that they had been sleeping for more than 300 years, they went into the cave and they died. And the authorities of that nation, who at that time had become Christians, that the emperor, the oppressor emperor, had passed away 300 years ago. And at the time, the companions of the cave woke up, people were Christians. So they decided to make a mosque, a masjid, on the cave of those people of the cave. In this story, one was the lesson of monotheism, and the second was the lesson of resurrection. And there was a lesson for the idolaters of Mecca. They were given admonition that actually what they were doing was similar to the behavior and to the actions of the oppressive emperor, the idolater emperor, who was cruel. While what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his followers were doing, those were similar to the actions of the people of the cave, because the people of the cave, they obeyed only one Allah, and they worshipped only one Allah. Also, there was a lesson for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his followers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala admonished Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he shouldn't make any compromise with the idolaters, and he also must keep the poor Muslim followers with him and should not expel them because the kafirs, the idolaters of Mecca wanted him to remove the poor followers of Islam from him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him this advice, while also the followers were given a lesson that they should do like the companions, the people of the cave. They left everything and took refuge in the cave, but they didn't discard the faith of monotheism. So the Muslims must be strong, and they must keep on the Islamic faith no matter how much difficulties they face. After this story, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then revealed some verses about the situation in hell and also in paradise. In hell, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave one example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that if someone in hell requests for something like water, so the water which will be given to him will be boiled very hot, like molten lead or like molten copper. It will be so hot that when he takes it to his mouth to drink, before it reaches his mouth, the fumes will roast his face. Such is bad drink there, and such is bad place to rest. Hell is a very, very bad place to rest. So we must protect ourselves from hell, while the believers with righteous deeds, they will be in the great blessings of paradise. They will live like kings there. After that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us the story of a man whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had blessed with two gardens, and also inside the garden there were farms, and there were springs of water, and the gardens were full of fruit and vegetables and many things, and he was enjoying the produce of the gardens. He believed in the existence of God, but he didn't believe in resurrection and accountability. So he became very proud, and he began to look down at his neighbor, and also he said that he didn't think that his gardens will be ever destroyed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought some type of wrath on his gardens. They got destroyed, and he began to regret because he didn't believe in the hereafter, and because he did associate partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Although apparently he didn't associate, but when a person does such, that means who himself considers to be independent like God, and he doesn't care about God. So he did commit shirk, and so he was regretting about that, and I hope that he may have found the straight path of Islam, because he was punished in this world, and when a person is punished in this world, it may be that he gets guided to the right path of Islam. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after this story, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the example of the worldly life. That it is like when rain falls on dry land, dry earth, it becomes green and it grows vegetation, and then that vegetation becomes dry and yellow and is flown away by the wind. So the real thing of benefit to mankind are the righteous deeds, due to which they will get reward with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the righteous deeds, the faith of Islam and the righteous deed, they are lasting and they will be of benefit to mankind. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also tells us about something about the day of judgment, that when that earthquake happens, the earthquake happens, and the mountains, they will be flying in the air like clouds, and Then the second stage will start after the destruction of the whole universe. The second stage will start, and we will be resurrected. All mankind and jinn, we all will be resurrected. And the book of deeds will be distributed. Everyone will get his book of deeds. So the criminals, they will be in terrible fear, and they will say, "Oh, what type of book is this, which didn't leave even a single thing, small or big, but has recorded it?" So Allah says that they will find everything that they did, and then the decision will be made, the judgment will be passed according to their faith and deeds. No injustice will be done with them. So whatever they get, hellfire or whatever, you know, they get the mu'mineen, the righteous doers, they will be in paradise, while the unbelievers and the disobedient, they will be in hell, and all that will be done according to their book of deed, and no injustice will be done to them. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shortly tells us about Adam alayhi salam and Iblis, Satan. That Allah subhanahu ta'ala, when created Adam alayhi salam, Allah ordered the angels to prostrate to Allah ordered the angels to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. All of them did prostrate except Iblis. Iblis was from jinn. He didn't obey the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cursed him, and then he challenged Allah that he would make mankind astray and lead them to hellfire. So Allah says that you are taking Satan and Satan's children as to be your protectors and friends, although they are very bad enemies to you. After that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again tells us something about the hereafter, about the day of judgment, when the criminals will be presented for accounting, and hell. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts the story of Musa alayhi salam and Khizr alayhi salam. In that story, there is a lesson for all of us, that whatever appears to us, the things happening, their evident side, that is different from the deep side of these happenings, because there is divine wisdom which is deep, and we don't understand it. At that time, Musa alayhi salam, he wanted to learn some special knowledge from Khizr alayhi salam. So Khizr alayhi salam had taken his promise that Musa alayhi salam would not ask him any question about the things that he did until he himself explained it to them. But Musa alayhi salam couldn't keep patient on the things, because the things which were happening were very, very strange. Like when they started their journey in a boat, Khizr alayhi salam tried to break the boat. So Musa alayhi salam didn't accept it, and he said, "Why do you do that?" Again, Khizr alayhi salam killed a boy on the way. Again, Khizr alayhi salam made a wall in a habitation where people, they were very rude, and they didn't do any hospitality to them. So Musa alayhi salam said that you could take wages from them. So in the end, then Khizr alayhi salam told Musa alayhi salam the deep facts behind those things that he did, and there was great wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, the boat that belonged to some poor people who used to earn their living with that boat, and there was a king on the way who was snatching all good new boats from people, and Khizr alayhi salam broke that boat so that that king doesn't take it from him. And similarly, there was wisdom in the other two happenings also. Then comes the story of Zulkarnain, the story of Zulkarnain. He was a great king, a great ruler, and Allah had blessed him with lots of blessings. And he was also a great conqueror who who traveled towards the east and towards the west and also towards the north, and he conquered many countries during his journeys. But wherever he went, he was very humble to his creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and very much obedient to Allah, and he established the rule of Allah in every place. And also his behavior, his attitude to the people was very kind. When he found some people who were in trouble due to Gog and Magog, because they used to come in a valley between two mountains, he made a very, very strong wall for them to protect them from Gog and Magog. And when he made such a strong wall, he didn't take any money from the people. All of the people, they presented their money to him for help, but he said, "What Allah has given me, that is enough. You give me only manual help and I will make the wall for you." And when he made such a strong wall, he was not proud about it, and he didn't trust it also. He said, "This is by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." And also he said that it will remain until Allah wants it to exist, and it will be destroyed when Allah wants to destroy it. So there is a lesson in the story of Zulkarnain also for all the rulers of the present and future. And in the past also, there was a lesson for the chiefs of Mecca, who had little things with them, and they were so proud of those things, and they were so proud against Allah, and they were fighting against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and were trying to suppress the message given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also they trusted their things. They didn't trust Allah, they trusted their things, and they were sure that no calamity will come on the things they owned. But very soon they were destroyed in the Battle of Badr, when they attacked Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his followers in Madinatul Munawwara. Most of the chiefs were killed there. So there was a lesson, great lesson, in the story of Zulkarnain also. And in the end, again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revises the statement about resurrection and monotheism. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala especially gives the example of some people who are busy in the achievements of this world, who struggle hard to achieve worldly gains, and they make great things, and they are happy and proud for those things. But in the end, when they die, they will go empty hands. They will not take anything with them, and the things will be destroyed here, left here, and destroyed here. And on the day of resurrection, when accounting is taking place, they will be having nothing. Their deeds will not be given any weight in the scales, in the balance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they will be the worst of the losers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And there are those people who actually don't believe in Allah and don't care about Allah's verses and Allah's signs and Allah's messengers. They make mockery of Allah's book and Allah's messenger alayhim assalam. And they will be destroyed, and they will become very bad losers, and they will regret without any benefit. While those people who do works here do struggle, but they believe in Allah and believe in their accountability and in the day of resurrection, and then they do things according to the instructions given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So their actions will be given weight in the scales set up by Allah on the day of judgment, and they will win, inshallah. And such people will be in paradise, and they will be very happy. They will like to stay there forever, because the blessings will be unique blessings. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in one verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned Allah's greatness, that if the whole ocean is made ink and we start writing the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means the excellent things that Allah does, the excellent works of Allah, which are due to the wisdom of Allah, the knowledge of Allah, and the power of Allah. If we start writing those things, they will not finish, and the whole ocean will finish. And even if we take another ocean, that will not be sufficient to write the excellences and the wonders of Allah's works. In the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they tell them that you are a bashar, a human being, but you are getting revelation from Allah, and the basis of the revelation is that your God is only one God, and therefore anyone who hopes, who believes that he is going to meet his Lord, then he must do righteous deeds, and he should not make any partner with Allah in the worship of Allah. That means he must purify his worship to Allah alone, one God Allah, to his Lord, one Lord and one God Allah, and he shouldn't commit any type of shirk. So the surah then ends on the command of monotheism, and also to believe in resurrection. One important point is that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited the building of masjid on graves. Wassallallahu ta'ala ala khayri khalqihi Muhammadin wa alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin.